help me understand, what does demand forecasting really truly mean for a retail customer?
So from a retail perspective, what most retailers are looking at is they're saying, we want to be able to better manage our costs.
Yeah.
And when you have too much product on the store floor mm-hmm. that is not selling, you're taking up that space that could have been used by another
True.
Product that is in demand. Customers are coming in, they're not finding what they want. The floor space is taken up by products that they don't want.
Yeah.
Now, how do we balance that? How do we ensure that we have the right products that you're looking for and we don't have too much of what you're not looking for?
Exactly.
And that's a fine balance. And it changes, it's dynamic, because the demand for certain products, the trends are changing. There are certain products that will spike in demand at a certain point and then
yeah.
just go down. There is seasonality associated with it. There is also sometimes certain products will no longer be in demand.
Mm-hmm.
How do you predict those things before they happen? Before I send all the stock to the store, I want to better predict to be able to send the right amount
yeah.
where I don't have a situation where customers are not finding what they're looking for. That's one driver, really, what
yeah.
retailers are saying. We want to be able to get better at that. We want to be able to know what product you really like, and without you actually telling us, we want to analyze your data, your
yes.
past purchases, your correlations, and infer from things like what movies you like, what books you like, and all those kind of things that tells us what service or product you could potentially like.
Okay.
And that's the area that a lot of retailers are looking at and saying, if we can get better at that, we're going to improve the performance of the store. We're going to be able to reduce the customer churn and improve retention
mm-hmm.
and drive customer acquisition. All those additional benefits are part
True.
Of that as well. So that's the area that most retailers are really looking at.
That sounds like an operations problem, but
mm-hmm.
I can imagine you can do better pricing with this based
right.
on if you can predict the demand of a particular item,
exactly.
you can price it better. What are the other use cases you've seen our customers use?
So in addition to the inventory and price, the,
yeah.
the other areas that I'm seeing is really the assortment about, you know, what are the sizes and colors and things like
yeah.
that. So that's one aspect of it that's extremely important. Using machine learning and advanced analytics and data to have the right supply chain in place as well
yeah.
to ensure that, you know, based on weather, based on current delivery times and things like that, can I fine-tune that
mm-hmm.
so the deliveries are just in time? So that's the other aspect a lot of retailers are looking at. Looking at also they are using data for better managing the workforce within the store for driving customer experience. They're
yep.
saying, if I can measure the traffic in the store
yeah.
over time, combine that with weather and events and all of that, and be able to better predict what's going to be my traffic at a certain time.
That
enables
idea.
Having the right products, having the right amount of staff so that I don't have a decline in customer experience and all that. So that's the other aspect that they're looking at as well.
So if a retailer knows that they'll get more people on Tuesday afternoons, they can have an extra shift or two so ensure
right.
that there are enough people to support their customers' needs.
Exactly. And those kind of forecasts predictions can actually get improved by pulling in event information.
Yeah.
For example, there's a football game, and you know that is a cause
yeah.
for traffic to decline. So I know I can better manage that process and things like that too, yeah.
Interesting. So we know on Super Bowl, we won't have too many people going
exactly.
to buy clothes.
Exactly, exactly. So those are the kind of things that you can better predict. Thanksgiving Day sales and
yep.
all those, you know, based on patterns to better predict that as well.
This is fascinating. Can you talk a little bit about some customer use cases that you've seen recently?
So there's a couple of customers. One of them is Pier 1.
Okay.
So Pier 1, what they were trying to do is they wanted to improve the conversion rate in the stores,
mm-hmm.
and they felt that the assortment that they had in the store was not the right level. And one of the ways that they addressed this to figure out what should be the right assortment by store was to look at their online data. So they had pier1.com, they had their weblogs that actually had information about the customer behavior when they went online. One is, where did the customers come from? Their location information was available to the weblog. What did they search for? What did they click on? And time of day and all those kind of things. So based on that information and demographic data from the U.S. Census Bureau, combining that with store locations to figure out these customer behavior that we're observing, what is the closest store for those clusters of customers, and then building models around that. So that enabled us to really say, what should be the assortment for a particular store based on the people around that store that went online, looked for certain products and categories at a certain time. So for a particular season, this is the popular product. For another season, it's a different set of products by store. And that was really the outcome of that predictive model, to really fine-tune and improve the assortment using data from online. Another example is really the Mars drinks, where for Mars drinks, it was really what we had was vending machines. And what Mars drinks wanted to do was better predict what products get used more and what products don't. And what should they wanted to ensure that that every product was available in the vending machine. There was no situation where certain products are not available, certain products never move.
So customers are never disappointed, but there's no overstock ever.
Right, exactly. So they wanted to prevent that overstock and understock, and they wanted to better predict the demand. In the case of Mars drinks, they also took into account all the external factors as well. Like, for example, what impact did weather have on consumption of products in the vending machines? What impact did external events and holidays and all those things have? So part of that training that they did for the predictive model was they took the historic data, as well as they took weather and events and so on. The historic data was really collected by putting sensors in the vending machines. So there was telemetric data being collected from the vending machines indicating what products are being consumed at which vending machine. So they could, at any time, look at a map of all the vending machines and figure out, you know, what's the consumption pattern? Is it different? How does it correlate to the demographics of the people around that area and so on? So they got some interesting insights from it. We're able to better predict what products to have in stock and things like that, and improve customer satisfaction.
So Sheesh, is it fair to assume that demand forecasting has always been around? Like every retailer always had to worry about things like stock outages or planning. But what has changed is that power of cloud streamlines these solutions. And a customer can get started with an intelligent solution in, say, weeks and sometimes, maybe sometime months, instead of years and years that it took for planning them. Is that the biggest thing, time to value?
That's one. And one of the most common things we've seen is really the accuracy of the predictions. Because with democratized tools, what we have really enabled them to do is to reduce or easily retrain the models. So because the process of retraining models, because the process of adding new data sets is very easy, most of the customers that we worked with started retraining their models more frequently, started using additional data sets to improve the accuracy. So that was some of the things that we saw as a benefit, where they could easily pull in, ingest data from public data sources, purchase data sources, retrain the model when they start seeing degradation or decay in the accuracy. So they could always keep that in good health, and that was really one of the benefits.
Wow, this is really incredible. This was super helpful for me to understand. I work on a lot of machine learning customers, lots of use cases, but it's helpful for me to understand the depth of what retail customers are doing.